It is wonderful to be here this morning.
Mm.
Annalisa and I spoke about that this morning. We are so privileged to have you and have it all, Lord. You have brought us the light in this time, and we want to thank you that you have revealed yourself to us and that you're doing so every day, more and more. Thank you that we can grow, Lord. Thank you that you tear down the shrines that we have in our lives. Thank you that you leave no room for other things in our lives, Lord. Thank you that we can trust in you when we can't trust in ourselves. Thank you that we can love you. In times, Lord, we find it hard to love ourselves. But we know that you love us. And you will not leave one stone not turned. Thank you, Lord, that we can love you. Let our worship today, our praises and our worship, be a sweet sound to your ears and may it fall in your heart, Lord. Every word that is sung, Lord, we mean it out of the depths of our heart. And those that cannot be here this morning, we think of them, we think of the notes as well, and Nelson, Lord. We miss them so when they're not here, but yet they're so part of this family. Thank you, Lord, that we can lift them up. For the other Davidsons that's not here, Lord, we also pray for them, Lord. And also, Lord, we want to thank you for what you've done for us through this week. Each one of us, Lord, you've taken through and you've led us during this week, Lord. We also thank you for, you know, Isaac and Andy and Ian that's been busy with a coffee shop, Lord. And we thank you that your hand has been in there, Lord, as well. We know that there's a purpose behind it. And we pray, Lord, that it will only go from strength to strength so that your word and your life can be shown to this world. We thank you for everything that you have done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Has everyone greeted everyone? Turn around, say hello. Hi.
Hallelujah, by and by.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed? Oh, glory. And therefore we live. Mm. Amen. Shout to the north.
Men of faith, rise up and sing of the great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak. In your brokenness complete. We will shout to the north and the south. Sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Rise up, women of the truth. Stand and sing to broken hearts. Who can know the healing power of our glorious King of love? We will shout to the north and the south. We will sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Shout to the north. We will shout to the north and the south. We will sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. We've been through fire, we've been through rain, we've been refined by the power of His name. We've fallen deeper in love with Him. You've burned the truth through dawn. Now live. So we'll shout to the north and the south. We will sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Rise up, church, with broken wings. Fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By His grace again we'll fly. Let's sing that again. Rise up, church, with broken wings. Fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By His grace again we'll fly. Yes, we'll shout to the north and the south. We will sing.
You may have your seats. Now, do we have any testimonies this morning? Yes? Andy? Come on up.
So the Lord's divine hand of protection is definitely on our lives. And so, you know, the other day I was at work and I had this saw and I accidentally touched the blade on the arm of the saw and it showered shrapnel of aluminium and it went all over my face and none of it went in my eyes.
Amen.
And so I just want to give the Lord praise because
Amen.
That stuff would be annoying in your eyes, you know? That would be bad. So yeah, he,
could be,
he
yeah.
does protect himself.
A slight case of annoyance, yes. Oh, glory to God.
Amen.
He protects us in those things.
Amen.
Yes.
And have confidence.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. I also want to just give a testimony similar to that line. A couple of weeks ago, I picked up Ed to go to work early morning, very early morning. So 5:30 we were driving. It was a stormy night. It was a Thursday morning, and the previous evening was quite windy, a lot of rain. Things happening, and we were traveling between Paraparam and Paikokariki, and you know there's a lot of roadworks on that road, and there were two trucks driving next to us, so one next to me and one in front of it, two long 22-meter trucks, and then a car in front of us. And what happened was during the night, all the cones blew into the road where we were driving, and we couldn't see. Because it was a lot of rain. We couldn't see far ahead of us. We could literally just see the car in front of us and the truck. And what happened was we saw the car swerve. And as the car swerved, it picked up the cones. There was about eight cones, five to eight cones. And my immediate reaction was to swerve. And I swerved. And as I swerved, I realized the truck was right next to us. And we would have gone, if I pulled it even harder, we would have gone under the trailer. And it was just instant. And as I realized it, I just held on to the steering wheel. And the cones hit us on the front right, wrecked the bumper. But we were okay. We were just fine. And what's funny is, we weren't fazed. We just carry on talking. So... It was only when I got to work, I didn't even check when I got to work because it was raining so much, I couldn't be fast. I just went up, did my stuff at work, and around 10, he asked me, so what was the damage on your car? And I said, oh, I haven't even looked. So I went down and I looked at the bumper, and yeah, it was completely wrecked. The water bottle behind the bumper was smashed, and the lights are gone, and yeah, so, yeah, no, glory to God, he protected us there. He has so many times on the road, hasn't he, Ed, when we were driving together?
No, I've got one as well. We were packing, I was packing, rearranging my garage yesterday, and my aim was to get both cars in there with all the bikes and everything, and it's so tight. So I've got my bike next to my Golf and the other boy's bike behind the Golf and all that stuff, and I took the remote and I said, told Lundy, I just want to check whether the coil and the arm misses all my bike stuff, and I'm behind the Golf, but I know there's about that much room for the door to close and me. So I'm literally in the way. I'll just stop the door, and then so I go, and I just, when I hit the button, I just hear this, and the door went off the chain. So the whole garage door started to slam on me, and I just closed my eyes and did this. And it missed me. I don't know how, I don't know why, I don't know who. The boys weren't there at that moment because it was in and out when they were playing somewhere. Yes, praise God, because it's a heavy door. I cannot lift it on my own. It is a massively heavy door. It missed me, it missed my bike, it missed everyone. Lundy is standing inside just freezing. He's like, are you okay? Yes, I think I am okay. And yeah. Until today, the mass in my head, I don't know, it missed me completely, it didn't touch me, and eventually we could open the door again, but it's so instant that we just, accidents happen, and but yeah, the Lord were there, the Lord was there.
Amen. Amen. All right, we've got a special this morning. So this is a song that Andy wrote. Andy, do you want to share about this song?
So this song, quite supernatural. Well, I believe all songs are supernaturally given, but this one was particularly for me given by the Lord. So I was praying, 6 months ago probably. When the youth camp first, we were going to go have youth camp, you know, and we heard what the camp was and who's coming and everything like that, and I thought, you know, this camp can change this whole nation. Can actually a polar shift of culture to heavenly culture, and by the change of the youth, because the youth, if the youth is on fire in a church, man, that church is powerful, you know. And so I just had a burden on my heart. It was real strong. I started praying, and I just really felt on my heart I got to pray for this camp. So I kneeled down, I start praying, and just a real divine inspiration came over me to pray that the Lord would personally come into that place and reveal His freedom to the youth. Because you see, at Calvary, He broke every chain, He loosed every bond, He opened every prison door, He set the captives free. So the only thing that holds people in a prison is a lie. It's a lie of the devil, it's a bluff. Because every person can walk out of a prison, can completely walk out of any complex, any issue. It's all been dealt with at Calvary. But it has to be, but you cannot imagine or you cannot try and make it yourself. It has to be revealed by Jesus personally. And so I'm praying on that line, and it was a real and nice, it was a good time. And all of a sudden, those words, the words of the chorus that we'll sing, came out of my mouth. And I thought, man, that's a song, you know. And so I felt an inspiration to write this song for the youth camp, but also for church as well and for us, because it applies to all of us. And it's a testimony. We're not just singing now a song, we're testifying of the freedom that He has revealed to us. And so, you know, we pray as we sing this song, and just pray also in your own time if you feel led to that when the youth sing this at camp, it'll really bless them and they'll realize their freedom. Amen.
Amen. It's quite interesting also, just to add to that, how we struggled with the song. Because this song has been on the band's to-do list for 2 months. It's about 2 months. And we struggled to put this together. And then on Thursday night, actually when I was driving in, I said to the Lord, you know, whatever is holding us back from getting this song done, just take it away. And then we spent a half hour on the song on Thursday night, and we nailed it. And the Lord just brought it together. So, yeah.
Darkness was my light. Everywhere I turned was night. But one day an angel came and broke away these chains. But one day everything's open, all these chains broken. There's nothing evil holding me. My prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free. God. With every lock broken, my heart is open. You've given me a brand new song. With utmost thanksgiving and heavenly singing, with utmost thanksgiving, my freedom claims that everything's open, all these chains broken. There's nothing my prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God. I'm free to walk with God. You are my freedom, you're everything I live for. Now everything's open, all these chains broken. There's nothing evil holding me. My prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God. Now everything's open, all these chains broken. There's nothing evil holding me. My prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God. I'm free. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God.
I stand in awe of you, Lord.
beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above, and I stand. I stand in awe of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due. I stand in awe of you.
You are beautiful.
You are beautiful beyond description. Marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who am grasped your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above, and I stand, I stand. I stand in awe of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due. I stand in awe of you. God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. I stand. The blind have sight, the deaf now hear, the lame will walk, the lost drawn near, and with new light the dead are raised, all through the power. The tired find rest, the sick are healed, the mysteries of our God revealed. And now the truth can be proclaimed all through the power in Jesus' name. Name above all names, Savior and our Lord. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess. No other name is given by which we can be saved. Let us find our life and love in Jesus' name. The thirsty filled, the hungry fed, and those who mourn are comforted. The chains are broken that have been slain. We're offered freedom in Jesus' name. Name above all names, Savior and our Lord. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess. No other name is given by which we can be saved. Let us find our life and love in Jesus' name. There is power. There is power. Power in Jesus' name. Name above all names, Savior and our Lord. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess. No other name is given by which can be saved. Let us find our life and love in Jesus' name. Name above all names. Name above all names, Savior and our Lord. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess. No other name by which we can be saved. Let us find our life and love in Jesus' name. Let us find our life and love in Jesus' name. Let us find. Let us find our life and oh Lord, we worship you. You are holy, beyond comprehension. You love us beyond comprehension. You've taken our lives into your hands, and we relinquish it to you, Lord. Do with us as you please, so that we can become more and more like you. Thank you, Jesus. Take my heart and help me feel. Take my faith and make it real. Take my eyes and help me see. All the love surrounding take my loss and take my gain. Take my trials and take my pain. Take my life and let it be. All that you could have for me. Don't let me go. Hold me close to where you are. Don't let me go. Take my heart, take all of me. Don't let me go. Hold me close to where you are. Don't let me go. Take my heart, take all of me.
Let's sing the second verse again.
Take my loss and take my gain.
Have a blessed time. Also, this is going to be the last, if anything's changed from the landlord side of things, this is going to be the last service we're going to have here.
Amen.
So next Sunday we're going to be up. Amen. So I'm going to hopefully get the key off him tomorrow, and then we're going to plan how we're going to move and everything. So we'd like to have a church photo in here after the service as well. Amen. So we're going up.
Amen.
If you'd like to... take the scriptures with me and I want to go into something this morning. Everyone feeling okay?
Amen.
It's very interesting. The song we just sung, Take All of Me. I want to approach a thought, if I may, but I just want to go to St. John chapter 11. And we're going to, we're just going to jump into the story of Lazarus. I know you know the story very well. And then we're just going to go from verse 21, then we're going to go down to verse 34. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. And Martha says something that everyone else, normally the whole world will confess. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. But notice Jesus, he brings it into now. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth and liveth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, Yea, Lord, I believe thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And then we'll go down to verse 34. As Jesus speaking, Where have ye laid him? And they said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus, and it says Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, Behold how he loved him. And some of them said, Could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused even this man, caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore again groaning in himself cometh to the grave. It was a cave and a stone laid upon it. And Jesus said, Take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. Jesus saith unto her, Said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? And they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And then he thus had spoken, and he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, Loose him and let him go. Amen. May the Lord bless his word. You may be seated. Now, we live in an hour of total victory. We live in an hour of total deliverance. We live in an hour where nothing can hold us in our walk with God. Amen. We live in an hour where Jesus said he came to set the captives free. Amen. As we heard Brother Burley the other Friday, he you know, if we read there in Luke chapter 4, that Jesus went into the synagogue and he found where it was written in the book of Isaiah, and he found that scripture that was pertaining to the day and hour that he was to fulfill the word. And he would read there from the book of Isaiah, and he would make a declaration that it was more than just reading a scripture because it sounded nice. It was more than just reading the Bible and looking for something that sounded good. But he made a declaration, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, This day, this scripture is fulfilled in your ears. Amen. He was making a statement. It was more than reading the Bible. But he was saying, This day, this scripture is fulfilled. Amen, where for 800 years this scripture had been laying in the scrolls of Isaiah, and man had been waiting for it to be fulfilled. But finally the one who came to fulfill it was standing upon the earth. Amen. And he wasn't making some idle boast, but you read in the Gospels, every enemy had to bow to him. Amen, legion came to him. And I just want to speak about grave clothes this morning, because some of us still have grave clothes on. Amen, a grave cloth is only on a person to keep a dead body together. But when life comes into the body, it just restricts the movement of the person. Amen. Amen. So there has to come a time where every grave clothes is stripped off the body. Amen. Amen. Where a son and daughter of God can walk according to as God wants them to walk. Amen. Hallelujah. We must not settle for second place serving the devil. Yes. Amen. We must not settle for just some religion. We must not settle just for having a nice time in church. Amen. We must never settle for those things, because that is not what God wants you to have. Amen. When Jesus gave his life on Calvary, he
He says, I have power to lay it down, and I have power to lay it, you know, pick it up again.
Amen.
And so he went. They didn't take him there. He took them there. Amen. It was all under his great control.
Amen.
He knew he had come into the world to set the captives free.
Yes.
Amen. The first declaration of Jesus' name upon the earth, you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins.
Amen.
That means a deliverance.
Amen.
Amen. We are living in an hour, friends.
Amen.
Don't pander to the devil.
Amen.
Don't live with something. People live with things for years and years and they say, well, it's just part of me. Stop taking ownership of what the devil's tried to stuff down your throat.
Amen.
Don't live under a complex.
Amen.
Don't live under a lie of the enemy.
Amen.
Amen. Because it says, the scripture tells us in Corinthians, it says those things which are seen are temporal.
Yeah.
Amen. Those things which are seen are temporal. But those things which are unseen are eternal. And that word temple means it's for an occasion only. It's to endure for a time. So it comes to an end. So temporal things, the things you see are coming to an end. They're not eternal things. They're not really real. Because there'll come a time where these things are no more. This building will be no more. This pulpit will be no more. This life, this world will be no more as we know it. Because it's a temporal thing. But yet it's amazing where man... You know, you can go back in your life and temporal things, which you won't even remember anymore, they will affect you in such a way that they change the course of your life.
Amen.
Right. Amen. You'll have, and you may not even be looking for something, but something just happens to you in life. And it's a temporal thing. But yet we will allow temporal things, amen, to dictate to us how our life is going to go and our outlook on life. That's a grave quote, friend. Amen. I trust you don't feel I'm preaching some kind of condemnation, but I want to see us free.
Amen.
Amen. We can't just sit back and say, well, everything's lovely. Look at all the people. We have a nice time.
Right.
You know, David came to a spot in his life. David came to a spot in his life where he didn't need to go fight no more. He was king. Everything was fine. He sent Joab out to fight, you know, take some kind of city. He just sat in his palace. He just came to a point where everything's fine. But it was in his point of just sitting back. Amen. We can come to a point where we just feel we don't need to praise the Lord anymore. We don't need to break through anymore. We don't need to walk with a humble spirit before God. Amen. And it's always pride before the fall.
Right.
Amen. Where people just sit back, and we're all prone to it. We're all human. But it was in David's moment where he said, I'm just going to sit back. Everything's fine. You know, my days of fighting are over. I've got the victory. Finally, I'm king. Finally, I'm in my position in Christ. Amen.
Right.
He says, now I'm just going to sit back.
Yep.
And then the devil, in his point of being relaxed, he looked over and saw Bathsheba.
Yeah. Right.
Amen. Because he got lazy in his walk. Hallelujah.
Right.
Amen. And it was that point where that happened to him. And then because that happened, he had the trouble from his family all the way down through.
Right.
Amen. With Absalom and Adonijah and all the different ones. Because he said, I'm just going to sit back. Everything's fine and dandy. Amen. And it was in that moment of weakness. We can't come to just a stale walk.
Right.
My heart's desire is never I don't just want to have church. Amen. The world's full of church and religion. We don't want religion and just church. Oh, it's a nice, oh, the singing's nice. Oh, tell me something new, preacher. I want to hear something new.
Right.
You know, if we get to that kind of state, you're sitting there like David. Yeah. Oh, now I know it all. Now I'm mature.
Right.
You've got to be careful. Don't think you stand, lest you'll fall.
Yeah.
Amen. Because when you come to a point where you think you have it all together, amen. And it's the biggest problem is when we look at others and we think, well, they're struggling with something, I'm better than them.
Right.
Or we look at another church and we compare this church with another church.
Amen.
And look down our big noses at some other group. They have had to walk a different walk than we've had to walk.
Yeah.
Amen. Never judge this group or your walk with someone else or some other church.
Amen.
Or some other ministry.
Amen.
The Corinthians were a carnal group.
Yeah.
And what was the first complaint you read in chapter 1? Paul says, Well, you say I'm of Paul or I'm of Apollos or I'm of Cephas or, you know. So what happened now is they begin to gather themselves around ministries. There's nothing wrong with the ministries, but the carnality of the people compared a ministry with a ministry. And then they begin to gather around those things and create division. Amen. Why am I saying these things? Because they were comparing themselves with themselves. And the scripture says if you do that, you're foolish. Amen. I'm better than this guy. What are we to compare ourselves with? Amen. This is our mirror.
Amen.
Amen. When you read this word or listen to the message, I trust you don't look for doctrine. I trust you don't look for things. Because this is, now the scripture tells us that we are to be conformed to the image of his son. Amen. We're called to be conformed to the image of his son. And the Son is the Word. Amen. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Then verse 14, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Amen. So that is the image we're to become one with. Amen. So now, when we read the Word, because remember, I may be jumping around, but I just stay right with me today. Because we're going to blow a hole in the devil's work.
Amen.
Amen. Because you've got to understand, the devil doesn't like us in harmony. The devil doesn't like us being free. The devil doesn't like us walking with God. The devil doesn't like us having church. He doesn't like it. And we always think, well, you know, because, you know, Brother Brown warns us, he says, you know, you're all sweet, humble group. But the devil will come along, he'll put someone in there, inject something, some poison through the church. He says, never take sides with it. Amen. And we think, oh, that'll never happen.
Right.
That'll never happen. We have gods among us. Sin started in heaven.
Yeah.
God was in heaven.
Yeah.
And Satan was there. And he was lifted up in pride. And says, I'm going to make a better kingdom than Michael.
Mm-hmm.
And so even in heaven, sin started in heaven. Mm-hmm. Amen. So you've got to be careful. You say, well, God's among us. Nothing can go wrong. It happened in heaven. That same battle has come down to earth. Amen. So you've got to watch. You've got to watch what the enemy tries to do. Because you've got to understand it's never your brother or sister. It's Satan. And he walks around like a roaring lion to devour who he will. He's not worried about them out there. He wants to devour you. He wants to kill you. Spiritually mar and kill you that you can't walk with God anymore.
That's right.
Amen. And he wants to cause something to happen, make this church a train wreck that we're just, because we never just want to look back and say, we had such glorious days. We are living in glory days.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. But that's why, you know, we can't just sit back and just take everything all easy.
Yeah.
We've got to endeavor to keep the unity of the faith and the bonds of peace.
Amen.
Amen. So now, when you read this, when you listen to the message, the word judges us now.
Yep.
Okay? We do not go to the great white throne judgment. The word judges us now.
Amen.
Well, how does that work? The word searches down to our very soul. Everything that's in us.
Yep.
Everything that's in our flesh, in our spirit, in our soul.
Yes.
And then the word now comes and it puts a finger on your life.
Yep.
And then that's actually God's judgment. Because he wants to take that thing and take it from you.
Yep.
He doesn't want that thing to stay in you.
Amen.
Amen. So now, when you're reading the word or listening to the message or in church, it's actually judgment starts at the house of God.
Yep.
Amen. Where the word comes and we're washed by the water of the word.
Amen.
So there's a washing that takes place to set us free of things.
Amen.
But if we hold on to things, we can't be washed. Amen. If we hold on to some spirit that's attached itself. Amen. Some spirit of pornography or lust or, you know, wearing shorts or something ungodly. Amen.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Because God sent a prophet to set us free.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's why many people say he's so hard, he's so cutting. No, he's doing that and he says, I don't want to say these things.
Right.
But if he says if I didn't love you, if I don't love you, well, I wouldn't say these things, but because I love you, I say these things.
Right.
Because, you know, if we could see the spiritual world,
yeah.
You know, have you seen it? I don't know if it's in the front there. Brother Bram, you hear him many times. He says, that man or woman shadowed with death, it's cancer. And one time there was someone with a camera behind him. And he pointed this woman, calling her out. Person takes a photo. And when it's developed, there's a black hood on the person. Amen. But then he calls it out. Faith rises and that spirit's cast out. Takes another photo and it's gone.
Amen.
Amen. But that was death on that person.
Right.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
And so we've got to, we really have to take the full brunt of the fact the devil is real.
That's right.
Amen. But God is in his people, but the devil's always nearby.
Yep.
Hallelujah. But our God is greater than any work of Satan.
Amen.
Amen. We've got to depend upon him.
Amen.
And if something is wrong, we've got to stop and got to say, what's going on, and deal with the thing.
Amen.
Because some people, they walk for years and years and years and years. But then they, because they develop some kind of reputation, I'm in the message. Oh, look at everything I know.
Right.
But then if there's something in there that needs to be dealt with, basically the person needs to be put on the wheel. Put into pieces and molded back again.
Amen.
But then what happens is because of, I have a reputation. What will this person think of me? Who cares what people think of you? What does God think of you? God wants you to be free. God wants you to be rejoicing. God wants you to have liberty. Amen. But pride hinders us. So now the word judges us. So when I heard a brother Francois Lippicard mention this, when he reads the word, listens to the message, it's now God's judgment coming. And he reads it that if there's anything wrong in his life, God can come and deal with those things.
Yeah.
Amen? Because we're laying ourselves. We don't have statues.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have idols.
Mm.
But the word, it's a living being.
Mm. Yes.
Amen? Our God is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen?
Amen. He's a living person.
Amen.
So when we worship him, we're actually prostrating ourselves in front of him, down at his feet. And if we're called to be conformed to the image of him, we're actually saying, Lord, mold me and shape me by your word into your image.
Amen.
Amen. But the problem is, if you're not willing to lay there and be willing for him to take everything from you, how can you be molded into his image?
Amen.
You have to be willing. You have to hate. You have to hate sin.
Amen.
If you ever spiritual battle with something. Amen. Because you've got to face it, this world. Music is such a powerful medium. The media, our world is saturated by the media. Amen. You can, you know, and off, you know, it's like, so for example, you see, you know, I was shocked. I was in Australia coming down through. I'm sitting in a food court in the Cairns airport, came from Papua New Guinea down. There's a Victoria's Secret shop there, which is lingerie. You know what I'm talking about. But it's there. There's the food court, all these kids, and there's this big screen. There's this runway walk there. These prostitute women that are bound by these spirits. I don't condemn the woman. It's a spirit on them.
Amen.
And so what happens is people, boys, see those things. Men see those things. Women see those things. And the spirit on them jumps onto the people.
Yeah,
they're not looking for it. The people aren't looking for it. But by seeing that thing and beholding it, the spirit comes on them.
Yes. Right.
Amen. It's true.
Yeah.
It's
Amen.
True.
Right.
And it happens everywhere.
Yeah.
But we have a God now that can set us free of those
Amen.
Things.
Amen.
And that's the reason I mention those things, because we maybe not be looking for it, but we're in these bodies. Mm. But you got to recognize having lust or something like that is not of God. Amen. You've got to recognize it. Oh, well, I'm just a red-blooded man or woman. That may be so, but don't let God pervert that.
That's right.
Amen. It's just like what happens is, you know, I was thinking in the scripture, God told Eve that your desire will be to your husband after the fall. So what does the devil do? Change a woman's desire that her desire is not to her husband.
Right.
Amen. But it's not, you've got to recognize it's not you, it's the devil tricking you. Don't take ownership of his devices.
Amen.
Whatever you do, don't take ownership of it.
Amen.
So now he says he lays himself before the word and he lets the word judge him.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Now, Cain and Abel. It's amazing with Cain and Abel. We often look at Cain and Abel and we think, well, Cain could never be saved. But God speaks to Cain in the scripture. He never speaks to Abel. And he says very plainly to Abel, to Cain. He says, just do like your brother does and you'll be received. It's that he gives Cain a chance. Amen. Because God is not willing that any should perish. He's not willing that any should perish. And even it says where Jesus speaks about the everlasting fire, the lake of fire, he says it's prepared for the devil and his angels. It's not prepared for man. It's not prepared for man. It's only prepared for the devil and his angels. But the thing is now, man is lost because they're not willing to lay themselves before God and be changed. Amen. God came to Cain. Here's the word. Just do what the word says, basically. Just do what the word says, you'll be accepted. But Cain wasn't willing to do what the word said. Amen. That's why you have a prophet standing this day. He speaks out about, women cutting their hair and wearing wrong things and men wearing shorts and drinking and smoking and all these things. Gambling and pornography and lust. He speaks all about those things. Because he's bringing it down because he wants you to be free of those things. Amen. Amen. Because, and he also brings it down because people, what happens is they justify themselves in that state, but they're religious. And their religion is their justification. Amen. And he even comes against the cold, formal, starchy people. Because that's just as bad. Amen. I want you to think about this. So he speaks along these things because he wants people to be free. The word came to set the captives free. And preaching the gospel sets the captives free. That's why that acceptable year of the Lord is the year of Jubilee.
Amen.
Amen. We have freedom this morning.
Amen.
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 If you want it, it's yours.
Hallelujah.
If you want it. Amen. But don't let the devil try and justify you. Well, you've always been this way. This has always been in your makeup. You've had this since you were a child. This is just your station in life. It's not for you. You're not good enough. We're all not good enough. We're all unworthy. Amen. But the Lord died to save the unworthy.
Amen.
He came to seek and save the lost.
Amen.
Amen. He came to Legion. Legion didn't start off with 1,000 devils in him.
That's right.
But he just took one step off the path. Amen. And then he started dabbling in something and it got something worse and worse and worse. And then he finds himself demon possessed, living among the tombs. And you see, why is this world so obsessed with skulls and death and
Amen.
All these things? Because it's that kind of spirit on the people.
Amen.
Amen. So now, but then Jesus didn't leave Legion in that state.
Amen.
Amen. But Legion had to come to the Lord. And if you will, free me. Amen.
Thank you.
And he didn't stay that way.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
He wasn't proud. Legion wasn't proud.
Amen.
Amen. Legion knew that he was lost and undone, but then Jesus came.
Amen.
And Legion didn't stay Legion.
Amen.
Amen. He was now delivered.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, so the scripture says that we're called to be conformed to the image of his son. This word conforms means to be fashioned like unto. So, we're called to be made into his image. And Cain and Abel had that opportunity where Abel knew it was blood. Life had to be given for life. He knew it was blood it was a blood sin in the garden. It wasn't fruit. But Cain had his own idea. But his idea wasn't vindicated by God. Because God accepted Abel's sacrifice.
Yeah.
Amen. And that means that Abel was accepted.
Yeah.
But Cain was too proud to admit he was wrong and do like his brother did. And pride. Now I just want to read something because I really want you to, because many people think, you're speaking about Cain, so you're speaking about denomination, or you're speaking about something that's out there. No. I want to read something from God of this evil age. He's speaking about Cain and Abel, or the spirits that are upon them have come all the way down to now. And he says, see the two opposing spirits at work in this evil age? Speaking about Cain and Abel. Can you see it? Each very religious. Cain and Abel, spirits again coming to their heads. Still same as they started. Same. Remember, Cain and Abel, they believed in the same God. They were in the same church. They all both came to worship. They knew they needed some kind of sacrifice to put them back to how they should have been. They knew they had sin. They knew they had to get rid of the sin. Amen? They all believed those things. But the difference between Cain and Abel was Cain was not willing to yield to the word when it came his way. Amen? Because God doesn't just put something upon us just to put something upon us. It's not a bunch of rules and regulations. It's actually, I want you to be free. That's what God wants. So that, pardon me. So now, still the same as they started. One worshipping by beauty and by knowledge and by education and by science and by ethics. So that's Cain. The other one by faith of the revelation of the word of God. Both of them is standing right in this building this morning. That's right. Revelation or faith in his word makes no claims of knowledge. The real true Christian, they say, well, you've got a doctor's degree, makes no claims. Believe his word, see? Doesn't make any claims, doesn't claim to be educated, doesn't belong to any denomination or party or sect. It belongs to Christ. Amen. It's his wife, not a church wife. She's a prostitute. The Bible said she was a whore and mother of harlots. And they came together to make the same whore. And that kind of a woman is a woman that's untrue to her husband and claiming Christ as her husband and belonging to a denomination. Such nonsense. You belong to Christ. So he's saying that in Branham Tabernacle, there are hundreds of people in there. He said those two spirits were down there where the prophet was delivering the word for the hour.
Amen.
Amen. Where some people were worshiping by revelation, others were just by intellect and education. Basically, they just learned that the message was right. Amen. They learned by seeing the signs and wonders that it was right. But the other group, it was revealed. This is Jesus, not the man.
Hallelujah.
But Jesus was revealing himself through the man.
Amen.
That this was now the Son of Man, Christ, being revealed through a Son of Man.
Amen.
Amen. But the difference now is Cain. You say, well, Cain wasn't ordained, but God gave him a chance. And I believe God wasn't doing it just to say, well, I gave you a chance. God was doing it because he actually wanted, he didn't want to see Cain lost.
Yep.
Amen. God doesn't do a vain thing.
That's right.
Amen. So you say, oh, he wasn't predestinated. Forget about predestination just a little bit. We can sit back, and the church world in the days of Wesley was like this. They sat back on predestination and Calvinism. Oh, if they're going to be there, they'll be there. If they're not, they're not. They just sat back. And God built John Wesley in such a way to swing the church back into the middle.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. But because we have a prophet now, it's right down the middle.
Yep.
Amen. The word is perfectly balanced.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's why it's good just to take it in the spirit that it's given.
Yes, sir.
But you see, pride. Cain was born first. Older brothers know best. He's proud. It says in Proverbs, pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Now, I'm still speaking about grave clothes. Amen?
Yep.
But you see, Cain wanted to keep his grave clothes. He wanted to keep them. Amen? Because it's just like religion is a covering. Amen? Religion is a covering. That's what the word religion really means. But he was too proud to give up his religion. Even though he believed in the one and true living God, and he believed that they had fallen and all those things. Amen. And he was in the true church at the time.
Amen.
And a haughty spirit before a fall. Better is it to be of a humble spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud. This is in Proverbs 16, 18 and 19. Now, the word haughty means an elation, a grandeur, and arrogance. Excellency, height, loftiness, pride. Amen. And pride, God hates God resists the proud. Amen. Oh, but I'm in the message. God is no respecter of persons. God is no respecter of persons. Amen. We've got to understand this. So, it doesn't matter if a part of the bride is proud or someone else is proud, God will deal with them the same way.
Amen.
Amen. That's why we should be on our faces thanking God for His mercy. Amen. I mean that with all my heart. We should just thank God. Amen. We're not bound by some religion. There's so much hypocrisy in the world. But there's a real genuine. And there's a real power of God to deliver and save. There's a real blood that was shed on Calvary. And there's a power that was loosed from that blood. Amen. That whosoever will can be delivered. Whosoever will can be free. Whosoever will can walk in the power of God like Jesus wants you to walk. Because there's power in that blood. And Jesus had to go to Calvary because He didn't want to keep all that power and He wanted it to be released. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because Jesus came to redeem.
Yes.
Amen. And His redemption is by blood and is by power.
Yes.
Amen. His blood was the purchasing price, and now His Spirit that came out of that blood is the power to set us free.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. People say it doesn't work. It does work.
Amen.
I've seen it work.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's how I know it's true. Because He delivered me, and I've seen Him deliver many.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's why there's nothing that the enemy, that's why you just got to give it all up.
Right.
I've been walking with God for many years. Just give it up.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm so glad Jesus set me free.
Hallelujah.
Now, pride started in the heart of Satan himself. He says, I'll exalt myself. I'll be like the Most High. I'll be worshipped. That was in his heart. Iniquity was found in him. And so pride started in heaven. And then he was cast down to the earth, and now it's in the hearts of men. Amen. And because Satan was so proud, because he was the worshipping angel, he is the cherub that covereth, he is a very beautiful being, and he's lifted up in pride. But he was cast down. And so pride is not of God. To have a proud spirit. Brother Bram says, I never want to let some proud, arrogant spirit get around me. Amen. That was the prophet speaking. That was an anointed one at the end time, I think he said, at the end of his ministry. So we never want to let some proud, arrogant, indifferent spirit get around us.
Amen.
Doesn't matter how new or old we are with God. If we, the more mature we are, the more humbled and thankful we should be walking with God. The more yielded we should be, saying, thank you, Lord. I'm no better than the one on the street, but you found me.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That's how we should be.
Glory,
amen. You think you know more than the next man, you should forget it.
Yes.
One thing you know nothing.
Right.
Amen. Just yield yourself to God.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Now, it says in James 4:6, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. He says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
Amen.
So if you want to resist the devil and him to flee, you need to be humble. Amen. And to resist the devil, the prophet tells us, is just flat down refuse him.
Yes.
Yep. Amen. But the challenge is, the spirits in the world, they're so connected to this flesh.
Yep.
And they're so connected to our spirits.
Yep.
Amen. So the devil can come along and, as I said, like he takes lust or desire for someone else that's not your spouse. And he'll take a genuine emotion you have for the right thing.
Yep.
Amen. And he'll pervert it like lust. Amen. And he'll pervert it. But your body, because it's used to feeling that feeling towards your spouse, which is godly and totally fine and undefiled. That's perfect.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. There's nothing wrong with it.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Love is a real thing. Love is not just a feeling.
That's right.
As well. Amen.
Amen.
That's why, I'll just say it, that's why it's called making love.
Yeah.
Amen. There's nothing wrong with that. In the right place. In marriage.
Amen.
It's a beautiful thing.
Amen.
Now don't get all stoic on me or Victorian. Amen. Nothing wrong. It says in here that the bed is undefiled.
Yeah.
Amen. In the right place. But the devil will take that and pervert it and make it for the wrong. But because your body is built such a way that it's right, he'll take those same kind of feelings and twist it to the wrong.
Amen.
And then now we're confused. Oh, but no, it can't, what's going on. It's actually a lust spirit trying to drive you away.
Yeah.
Amen. You have to recognize that. And you have to recognize if it is such a way, you have to refuse it. Amen. Just like it's just like anything, like coveting something or having a desire for something that's wrong. It's a spirit driving you. Brother Bram says in a quote, I think I have it here, he says, habits are spirits. Amen. I've just got this such a nervous habit. It's actually a spirit making you nervous. And it may not necessarily be possession, but it can be oppression. Amen. Just like cigarettes or drinking or gambling or running around with women, whatever, computer games or entertainment of the world, there's an anointing on that thing. And it comes down into people. Amen. You say, well, I don't think that's so. You know, witchcraft and all this stuff. There's spirits in those things.
Yeah.
Amen. It's not just people going through some silly ritual. They actually get anointed. Amen. And there's an anointing. But it's not God. Amen. And what is it mainly caught up in? Music.
Yeah. Right.
Amen. And then so now they take that. And why are some songs, like you just think about some songs. If you just read the lyrics, like modern songs, the lyrics really mean a whole bunch of nothing.
Yes.
It's just ridiculous. But yet people are so catchy and the whole world singing it. Oh, I love this song. Why is that? Because there's an anointing upon it.
Yeah.
And you'll find people that listen to certain kinds of music begin to. So, for example, country music, it's all my baby left me and I'm depressed and down. And, you know, what happens? Those people become depressed and down. Amen. There's music out there which is anointed with lust.
Yeah.
Oh, amen.
Yeah, right.
Now, don't look at me like, oh, I've never heard this before. Amen. That's, you know, there's some like rap music, there's anger and violence.
Yeah. Yeah.
Brother Kydro Diggs, who's coming here, he says, he knew of people and they would listen to a whole bunch of rap music before they go kill someone because they come under the anointing of it. Amen. Why is it you see in Africa in different tribes they begin to sing and worship and dance around before they go into battle? Because they're calling upon a spirit of their God to come upon them. The Romans did the same thing. They offered sacrifices to their gods.
Yep.
Help us win this victory, Mars or whoever it was. They'd kill her, whatever they did. And, you know, they're calling for a spirit to come and help them fight the battle.
True.
Amen.
Yeah.
Because there's an anointing behind these things.
Yeah.
And you've got to recognize the anointing. And you've got to recognize what it can do to you.
Amen.
It doesn't mean you're lost and undone.
Yeah.
Amen. But that you still are in the same body the rest of the world is in.
Right.
You still have the same human spirit that they do.
Yeah.
Amen. But the only difference is God is in the soul, if he is.
Yeah.
Amen. Because if he's not, the enemy will come your way and you'll fall.
Yeah.
Amen. And you'll fall and fall and fall and fall. But then now when the strong man comes in, the Lord comes in, you'll be victorious.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's why we need him. We need him. And if you can fall, you say, well, how do I know the Spirit of God is within me? When the word comes forth, you say, amen.
Amen.
It doesn't matter if it strips hides off your back, you'll still say, yes, Lord.
Amen.
Whatever you need to do to me, do it.
Amen.
Whatever you need to rearrange, you rearrange it.
Amen.
Yes,
Lord.
Amen. So he gives grace to the humble. Now this word grace, which is from the Greek, graciousness or gratifying, is of manner or act, which is abstract or concrete, literal, figurative or spiritual. And it means especially the divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in the life. That's what grace is, a divine influence upon your heart. Amen. It's not God winking and, oh, it's fine, I love you. Keep going on. You can stay in your sin. Jesus never left people in their sin.
Right.
He delivered them and he said, go and sin no more,
amen,
lest a worse thing come upon you.
Right.
That's what he says in the gospel. He doesn't just say, keep going on, I forgive you, I love everybody.
Right.
You know, the rich young ruler, he comes to Jesus in one of the accounts and it says Jesus loved him. I want you to think about this. He says, now Jesus, but Jesus loves me. Jesus loved the rich young ruler. But here comes a man, his whole life was built about his religion. But he knew he didn't have eternal life.
Yeah.
He says, good master, what shall I do that I inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, well, you know the commandments, you know, and he lists a few. And then, but then this man says, I've kept the commandments from my youth. So he was a good message believer because he believed the message of Moses. He was a good message believer. I've been a good boy. I've been in Sunday school. I've been in church. I've honored my parents, you know. And then Jesus, because it says many times in the scriptures, Jesus knew what they were thinking. He discerned their thoughts.
Yeah.
So if this man, this young boy was lying to him, Jesus would have said, you hypocrite. He wasn't afraid to call black, black, and white, white. But then Jesus said, one thing you lack. Sell all that you have. Take up your cross. The reproach of the word. What people will think of you. Put it on your shoulder, take up your cross, and follow me. And what was the end of the story? He walked away sad because he wasn't willing to give it up. He was too proud. He was someone who should have been conformed to the image of the Son. Amen. But he wasn't willing. But his religion, it was just grave clothes. It was just holding a dead body together. Amen, because we were all dead in trespasses and sins. Amen, so it's just grave clothes holding a dead body. But now here was eternal life that was wanting to give this body life. But he was too proud to lay it all down.
Yeah.
Oh, what will my family think of me giving all my riches away? What will my friends think of me? They hold me in such high regard. What will my church think of me? Because in those days it was a reproach to follow Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And it still is today. They were kicked out of the synagogue. If you go to any of his meetings, you're not welcome back here again.
Right.
Told all the priests and Pharisees, have nothing, you know. They plotted to destroy him.
Yeah.
They were angry, filled with wrath when Jesus healed the sick and raised the dead and all these things. How are we going to destroy this man?
Yeah.
Do you think they didn't tell their people?
Amen.
They put it on their website, sent an email out.
Right.
WhatsApp chat. Have nothing to do with this renegade from Nazareth. He's Beelzebub. That's what they said.
Yeah.
They called him the Prince of Devils.
Yeah, right.
So it was a reproach to follow Jesus Christ in those days.
Amen.
So that's why the rich young ruler, he had to take up his cross. Amen. Pick up the reproach of the word. Who cares what? Well, you know, the devil, he always wants us just to keep the status quo. Just go to church, but don't get too enthused. Read the Bible, but don't let it change your life. Pray, but don't really pray through. You know, oh, God hears you. You can just continue on. You know, say God bless you. Just live a good, simple Christian life. And we are to live a simple Christian life. But it's more than just floating along.
That's right.
Everything's fine. That's the problem with this country, friends. We have things too easy.
That's right.
We have everything at our fingertips.
Yes.
Amen? So it's just float along. And it's New Zealand. There's a spirit in this work, in this country.
Yeah.
Tall poppy syndrome. Cut them down.
Yeah.
Anyone tries to do something different, just cut it down.
Yeah.
Oh, you're different to us. We hate you. You have no place in this country. Right. Amen. Status quo. Keep the status quo. Conform to the culture.
Yeah.
That's the pressure we live in this world.
True.
Are you with me? This country.
Yeah.
You've got to understand there's a spirit in this country.
Yep.
Why aren't we like Russians? Because there's not a Russian spirit here.
Right.
Why aren't we like the Chinese? We don't have a Chinese spirit.
Right.
Why aren't we like the Americans? We don't have an American spirit. Yeah, Brother Bram said, you go into a country, you find a spirit there. All the Germans are all military and serious. In America, there's a ha-ha kind of spirit. You know, France is all, you know, like frolic and just wine and just relaxing and what, you know. You find all those things in different countries. We are affected by the spirit in our country.
True.
That doesn't mean we're anointed by it, but it still has an effect.
Yep.
Amen. So the whole status quo, just float along. Everything's fine.
No.
Amen. That will try and affect you.
Yeah.
Right.
Amen. That's why you look at different churches, you look in different countries. The believers battle different things. Because there's a principality of Satan in that country that has dominion. But it's different anointings in different countries. Amen. So we have to be aware. That doesn't mean that we belong to the devil. Amen. But if you just float along, everything's fine. Amen. Oh, we only have those experiences at camp. And now, thank God, we just have them at prayer meeting. You know, it's just there. It's not when we leave. Oh, we don't have church like that anymore. We used to have church like that, but we don't have church like that anymore. I used to pray like that, but I don't pray. You know when you pray and God takes over?
Amen.
Amen. And you're screaming and shouting and tears are pouring down your eyes and your face is full of snot. You're just so happy.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. You know that?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Don't settle. Now, I'm not saying go for an emotion. But then what if I just said, well, I just don't pray like that anymore? Mm. We've matured.
Oh, my.
No, you've been put on the shelf and you've gone stale.
Mm. Right.
Amen. The biggest, Brother Bram says, to overcome, you got to keep life about you.
Yeah. Right.
Amen. You got to keep life about you. He said he was walking, he was hunting, and there was this big log that was in a stream. And he went to go step on this log and a whole bunch of the, you know, wood just broke off because it was rotting. So the tree was in the stream. We're washed by the water of the word.
Yeah.
Amen. The tree was in the flow of the water. But because there was no life in the tree, it was just rotting away.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. And it's the same thing with us. Oh, God did those things for me years ago. Yeah, the worst thing you could ever say to someone is, I remember being like that.
Oh, man.
Amen. I remember those days. Never, ever. If you get to that point, you should come and pray.
Amen.
You say, Lord, renew unto me the joy of thy salvation.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Renew the joy of it.
Yes.
You know, it's like what is a marriage? Never ever let the spark die.
Amen.
Between husbands. Just never ever let it die. And if something's made it die, it's actually the enemy tried to come in because he just wants it to cool off. What was the complaint against the first church? Thou hast left your first love.
Yeah.
Amen. You know, the devil doesn't want you to be all happy and in love and just, you know, sure, there's the children, there's the busyness of life. But somehow, amen,
yeah.
Somehow say, Lord, I want to keep the spark in the fire.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Because if you just sit back and say, well, this is just how it is, well, that's all you'll get. But if you say, Lord, I want that love back and how it should be,
amen.
Then he will grant that, give you the desires of your heart,
amen.
And he will give it to you.
Amen.
If you just keep seeking him for it.
Amen.
It may not come overnight, but just keep seeking him for it.
Amen.
Amen.
True.
Because it's one thing to sit there and say, well, this is how it is. But it's another thing to sit there and say, Lord, I want it back. I want more.
Amen.
Amen. So, he gives grace to the humble. And that is a divine influence upon the heart. So, grace, as I said, is not just God saying, go on in your sin. But God influences your life. And grace enables you to walk above sin.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. It's exactly what it does. And then now, he says in 1 Corinthians 10 and 12, wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. Mm. Oh, I've got it all. There is no temptation taken you such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. Mm. Amen.
Right.
I don't think I can handle this. God thinks you can handle it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen. 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 You just got to have that rest. Oh, I don't know if I can survive this one. God knows you can.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God knows everything will be okay. Because he doesn't give you more than you're able to bear.
That's right.
Hallelujah. But he'll make a way of escape. You got to look for the way of escape.
Yeah.
Amen. That's why you just never look at the situation. Look at the way of escape. Look for a way out. Lord, what are you teaching me through this?
Yep.
What do you want me to learn?
Yes.
Amen. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry, is the next scripture. Now, idolatry, you know, is to make something I could worship anything. I can worship this TV. I can worship this microphone. I can worship the piano. I can make anything an idol. do not... Now, when I read this, I thought it was interesting how Paul puts flee from idolatry just after this. Because what happens is, if any man... Wherefore, let any man that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall.
Amen.
What happens? He begins to worship his own walk with God.
Right.
He makes his own walk with God an idol. I know what the seals are. I know how the whole plan of redemption goes.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Whatever you want to put there. I know how it all fits together. Oh, you've been around so long, I'm just here. God just reveals it to me. And he does. But with that revelation, you've got to make sure it doesn't let you become proud. Peter had the revelation, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. But then, just a few moments after that, not that long after that time, Peter says, you know, because Jesus says, you know, I have to go die on the cross, but in 3 days I'll raise again. He says, you know, Peter says, oh, I won't let anyone do it. And then Jesus looks at his eyes and says, before the cock crows, you'll deny me 3 times. But because he was proud, oh, I have the revelation now at the Christ. No one else said it. Oh, God is revealing things to me so well. I walked on the water. No one else walked on the water. I nearly drowned, but I walked again. Amen. There was divine revelation came in, but his human element became proud. And because he was proud, he basically looked at Jesus and he didn't say it, but in his mind he said, you're wrong. I won't deny you. You're wrong. Amen. He did. Because he didn't believe. Here was the word speaking to him. Amen. And he basically said, you're wrong. You're the Christ. You are God made flesh, but you're wrong. Where did that come from? That was Satan in the beginning. Looks at God and said, I'm going to have a kingdom better than your kingdom. I will not be. He would have heard Isaiah's prophecy. Thou will be sent down to the pit. And he looked at that. He says, no, you're wrong. Because he was proud. Amen. And Peter was proud. Remember, we're going to lay ourselves before the Lord. Let him purge everything out of us that's not of him. We have to let him do it. If Peter said, now this is just me, but I believe, this is just what I believe. If Peter actually went down on his face and said, Lord, I don't want to, okay, Lord, amen, you know, please don't let me do it, amen. In other words, you're right.
Yes.
You're right. Your word is right.
Yep.
He wouldn't have denied the Lord 3 times. He wouldn't have gone through all those things. But because of his pride, God had to take him through the ringer,
yep.
Amen, to get those things out of him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So you have to flee from idolatry. Amen.
Yeah.
Never think, just like, to be honest, never think we have it all together.
Yes.
As a people, we're still growing. We're still maturing. They're still molding and shaping and things to happen. So don't think, oh, we have it all and we become the standard.
Amen.
We are not the standard.
That's right.
The word is the standard.
Amen.
Always remember that. And never look at other families and other children and say, well, if they were like my kids, they would be better. No, you've just made yourself the standard.
Amen.
He's the standard.
Yes.
Oh, I wish their marriage was like our marriage. Don't make it the standard.
Yes.
There's always more and greater you can have.
Hallelujah.
Amen. If only they did things my way. Who says your way is the right way?
Amen.
Amen. That way may need to be rejiggled and honed a little bit. And then now it's a different kind of way. Amen. Now, Jesus, now I just want to come back to Lazarus. Lazarus was there in the tomb 4 days. Jesus knew he'd be in that condition. He wasn't afraid. Jesus wasn't afraid to let his friend die. Strange thing, isn't it? And now the people there, just like many, they took man-made things to keep the body together. They took grave clothes, temporary things. Temporary things of life they used to bind the body together. But Jesus didn't want Lazarus to stay in that way. Amen. And so, we read there, Jesus went to the grave, and he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And Brother Bram tells us that if he didn't name him by name, there would have been a general resurrection. Because he is the resurrection and the life. And so now, The word is Jesus himself has come into this end time. I mean, the same God that was at the tomb is here. And he has spoken his word and he's called you. He's called you by name. In his word, he's called you. You may never have heard your name literally, but by him speaking out of the message to you, that's him calling you by name, saying you're part of this word. So he calls you forth and now life is in the body because we were once in dead and trespasses and sins. And then now the stone is rolled away and you walk out of the tomb. But there's grave clothes. There's temporary things, temporal things that have affected your life. Amen. There's life in the body, but there's temporary spirits. The devil is a temporary thing. Amen. Any spirit of the enemy is a temporary thing. And it will burn and will be destroyed. But they're temporary things. And people will let themselves be bound by temporary things. A complex is a temporary thing. How do I break a complex? Do the opposite. Do the opposite. If you can't forgive, forgive. If you can't be humble, be humble. If you can't be wrong, say I'm wrong. That's how you break it. Do the opposite. Well, I can't take correction. Just take correction. Amen. You just do the opposite and it'll break the complex. It's grave clothes. Amen. But Lazarus can say, but I'm alive. But you look at him, but he's bound. He can't run. He can't. Probably shuffles out. Amen. God doesn't want us in that state. I'm just going to kind of finish on this thought. Because unless you're willing to give it up, amen, unless you're willing to forgive, unless you're willing to surrender it, God can't take it from you. Cain was proud. I don't believe I'm looking at any Cains in this. Well, I was thinking about this last night. Samson gave his strength to God, but his heart was to Delilah. Amen. And look where he ended up. Because he didn't give his heart to God. He only gave part of himself. He would have said, remember he was a judge. He would have said, but I'm a believer, I'm a judge. I have a position of authority. I have an office in the church. I'll say, I'll put it on my lap. I'm a pastor. He gave that to God. But he didn't give his heart to God. Amen. He was too proud in his position. And you read in the scripture, he always goes back to the Philistines. I want a Philistine girl. I don't want an Israelite girl. I want a Philistine girl. Amen. You say, well, he was ordained to do those things. I say in this hour, the bride is not to be meant to be living in sin. Amen. Because it brings reproach to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. If Samson gave his heart to God and his strength to God, he wouldn't have ended up in that predicament.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. Amen. But you say, well, but the thing is, the difference between Cain and Samson and you is they couldn't have a new birth. They had to keep that first nature. But the blood of Jesus Christ can make us a new creation.
Amen.
Amen. So we don't have to stay as a Samson or a Cain. Or whoever you want to put. Because some people say, oh, you're calling me a Cain. No. Well, maybe the word is calling you a Cain, but you don't have to stay that way.
That's right.
If you want to be changed, you can be changed. There is power in this room to change everyone who wants to be changed. Amen. I'll put my life on that. There is power in this room. Anyone who wants to be changed, anyone who wants to be free, they can be free. Amen. But you have to want to be free. And you have to hate the thing that causes the sin. If you don't hate it, how can you be free?
Amen.
It's like a slave. If a slave loved his slave owner, he didn't have to go free in the Jubilee.
That's right.
Amen. But if he knew I have a possession and this is not where I'm meant to be, and he heard the trumpet and he would have hated the slave master, I have to stay and work for this guy. And he beats me, he doesn't feed me very well, I've got to work long hours. There would have been hatred in there.
Yes.
But if he loved him, he would have stayed.
Yeah.
It's like the maniac that came up before Brother Brown, the real big guy. Demon-possessed man, he said, and he walks up, spits in Brother Brown's face, he says, I'll tear you limb from limb. And Brother Branham, he was a boxer before he met the Lord, remember? But he actually felt sorry for that man. Because he was bound by a spirit driving him to do those things. And actually, divine love was actually projected. And The Lord spoke through him saying, because you challenge the Spirit of God, you'll fall at my feet. And then the big man says, I'll show you who's going to fall at whose feet. And he fell down. He went to punch him and he just fell down at his feet as a dead man. The police went to come and pick him up. He says, is he dead? No, he's not dead. Is he free? No, he worships that spirit. That's why he's not free. We're all men. We're same flesh as blood as that man. We are the same. If he didn't worship that spirit, he would have been free.
Amen.
And it's the same thing with us. We have things that beset us, have been in our lives, been in our spirit, they just sit there. And you got to be careful because when God comes, sometimes things hide. Amen. And it hides away. If it's not delivered, it's still there. And then at a time when you don't see, it comes back. And you say, what happened? I say, you weren't truly set free. Amen. So don't, whatever you do, don't cover up things. Oh, because I'm in the message and people will think bad of me. The devil has to be exposed.
Amen.
Before he's cast out.
Amen.
Amen. And if there's unconfessed sin or you've got to make something right with someone else, you've got to do those things. Just like Brother Burley read about the quote. Said about that woman and she had committed adultery and her husband had committed adultery. Amen. She had to go put that right, and then he said, then the prophet said, then I can cast or control that demon.
Mm.
Those things had to be put right first, and then God can work.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen. But if you want to be free, oh, I can manage this. No, it'll manage you.
Yeah.
It'll manage you. You'll be walking along one day, and there you go. And the fall of the house will be great. Amen. But it's not out. But Jesus wants us to be free.
Amen.
He wants us to walk free.
Amen.
He doesn't want us. What did Jesus say? Loose him and let him go. Amen.
Yeah.
He said to his disciples, I've spoken the word, now you loose him and let him go.
Yeah.
And that's the job of the ministry. Loose the people and let them go.
Yeah.
Amen. So if you want to be free, there's liberty to be had.
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand to our feet, shall we? We have some musicians to come. This is an hour of deliverance. Amen?
Amen.
The reason I say these things is we don't want to let the enemy have any advantage of any life. Amen? We don't want to live below our privilege. Amen? So there has to come a... I'll tell one more story. Brother Barham sent prayer cloths all around the world. He sent one to Germany. There was a woman in a wheelchair, crippled. And she got the prayer cloth. And she said, well, I've confessed all my sins. I've made everything right. She put it on her and she walked out of the wheelchair just like that. Because she put everything right.
Amen.
And then she walked out of the wheelchair.
Amen.
Amen. And it's the same thing. You may have to go put something right with someone. You might need to forgive someone. Amen. But it gives, you know, it says in the book of Ephesians, do not give place to the devil. How do you give place to the devil? Unconfessed sin, unforgiveness, resentment towards someone else, bitterness, whatever it is. Amen. And so those things happen, and then the devil comes in, attaches himself in that part of you, and he begins to operate. Amen. But the Lord wants us free.
Amen.
He wants you free. Amen. Whom the Son has set free is free indeed.
Amen.
You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Amen.
It'll make you free.
Amen.
When something is made to do something, it's against its will.
Amen.
It's like this Bible. I'm going to make it move. Now it's here. I'm going to make it open, and now it's open.
Amen.
I'm going to close it. I made it close. I'm going to put it back here. If it had a will, well, I'm sorry, my will's greater than that. I'm going to make it do things. It's the same thing with the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Amen. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. If anyone needs prayer, you're more than welcome to come. If you want to be remembered in prayer, you just want to raise your hand. But if you want prayer, you're more than welcome to step forward as well. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, you want us free. Lord, you don't want us to be bound by grave clothes. Lord, you don't want us to be bound by any spirit of the world.
Yes,
Lord, you don't want us to be bound by any complex. You don't want us to be bound by our past. Lord, you don't want us to be bound by anything that's not of you. And Lord, we're so glad we can just lay ourselves at your feet and say, mold us and shape us into your image, Lord. Father, you are here. Lord, your word has come forth. Now may the people respond. Lord, may people not hold on to anything. May they not take ownership of the devil's lies. Lord, or some demon spirit that's been afflicting them. Lord, may they lay it at your feet and just walk on. Father, this is the hour of deliverance. We'll not have the enemy destroy your children. And we stand against the powers of the devil in the name of Jesus Christ. We say, Satan, you're a defeated enemy. Loose these people and let them go in Jesus Christ's name. You're a defeated being and we reject your working in Jesus Christ's name. And we command you to leave the people. Satan, come out of everyone in Jesus Christ's name. Oh, now, Lord, have your way among us, Father. This is the part of the service where we respond back to you. Lord, may you grant it in Jesus Christ's name. Father, I commit everyone into your hands in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Let's just sing that song. Oh, I know the time is near. Amen. But if anyone wants prayer, you're more than welcome to come now and I'll pray. I'll pray for you. Amen. Because remember, we all have to give an account. I want you, and I'm going to speak on this one of these days. We all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Amen. For the works we do in this body. Not for salvation. Salvation's done. But we stand before his judgment seat and give an account on everything we do. Not for salvation. You can't be lost there. We have eternal life now, but you have to give an account. Amen. And he'll ask you, why didn't you let that thing go? Why didn't you let yourself be set free? Why'd you let your pride hinder your walk with me? Amen. Some people, they'll be asked that question. Hallelujah. They'll still go into eternity in glory, but they'll still have to answer those. They'll have to give an account. Amen. That's why we want nothing holding us back. Amen. Just as a brother said, I want no trouble at the river when I come down to that day. Amen. Why do some people miss the rapture? I just want to put predestination to one side. Because they're not willing to give it all. I'm not sure. We should check up, church. Amen. If we go too far on the well, God will deal with me. God will get me there. You have to let him deal with you first. And then he deals. He doesn't deal if you're not willing, because he's a gentleman. As I've said, he doesn't mug you. Take things from you, beat you up, take things from you. He says, can I take that from you? Amen. And this is why we're here this morning. Amen. Because the Lord's saying, give it to me. You probably all have things on your heart or mind, you know what you need to give up. Amen. Don't hold on to it and say, well, I need time. Just say, here it is, Lord. Amen. We need to be broken down and molded again. Amen. From me to everyone. Yep. Amen. We can't keep going in this way. Amen. We need a real consecration, a real dedication back to God.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
So if you need prayer, you're more than welcome to come forward. Amen.
Mercy and all my dear. Peace. Of times I've sailed through life's stormy gales, the situations all proclaiming you will not prevail. But your word says thou rulest the raging of the seas. When the waves thereof arise, thou stillest them, Jesus. There is nothing that I need to fear. You're here. You're here. There is nothing that I need to fear. There is nothing that I waves you won't break me, storms you won't shake me, Jesus is here. Oh, ye tempest, you will all be one day an angel these chains broken. There's nothing evil holding me. My prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God. With every lock broken, my heart is open. You've given me a brand new song. With utmost thanksgiving and heavenly singing, with utmost thanksgiving, my freedom claims that everything. All these chains broken, there's nothing evil holding me. My prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free. down by the river, he's waiting for me to bathe me in his spirit, to wash away my sin. Glory be to Jesus, the gardener of my heart. Glory be to Jesus, the raging seas. He stood on Calvary. He walked the desert deep and dined with the weak. He came to me today and met my every need. The everlasting God. Now by the water stands the everlasting vine, to pour out all his mercies and save with grace divine. Glory be to Jesus, voice to all my storms. Glory be to Jesus, the hope of all. He walked the raging seas, he stood on Calvary, he walked the desert deep and dined with the weak. He came to me today and met my every need. The everlasting God. He walked the raging seas. He stood on Calvary. He walked the desert deep and dined with the weak. He came to me today and met my every need. The everlasting God. He alone is worthy. He alone, Almighty, King of all the ages, King of mine own heart. He walked the raging seas and stood on Calvary. He walked the desert deep. He alone is worthy. He alone, Almighty, King of all the ages, King of mine own heart. He walked the raging sea. He stood on Calvary. He walked the desert deep and dined with the weak. He came to me today and met my every need. The everlasting God. He came to me today and met my every need. and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not
Thank you.
was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. I first chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns unending. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God. My God, my Savior. on your knees
in the garden of Gethsemane. You poured out all your pleas, saying, Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me. Let not my will, instead let your will be done. Lord, you have taken the enemy's crown. With pain in the darkness, you had me found. We're marching in step with the
hour can stop his kingdom come. In you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Brother Armand, can you come and close the service in a word of prayer, please?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'm glad. We're free. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's just bow our heads. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, so wonderful to be in your presence.
Lord. Yes, Lord Jesus.
Lord, so wonderful to see how you break every chain.
Hallelujah.
How we can just humbly come before you today, Lord, and say you are our King.
Amen.
You are our Kingsman, Redeemer, our life, our everything, Lord
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Lord, let us not be proud, Lord, and just come before you and say, whatever you will be done, you will be done, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
For you are sovereign and you are God.
Amen.
Lord, and we are your people, and we just stand here before you, Lord, and say, Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Lord, thank you for this special, special time with you, Lord. We really, really love every chain be broken.
Hallelujah.
The devil under our feet, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Defeated that day on Calvary, Lord.
Amen.
Nothing we can do, Lord, out of ourselves can draw us closer to you, Lord, but you that draw yourself to us, Lord. We lay upon your feet, Lord, just put your garment over us, Lord.
Amen, Lord.
May we just lay there in the presence of the sun being
yes,
ripened,
Father.
Lord. May this week be a victorious week, Lord.
Amen.
May we confess and profess, Lord, that you are the King of our hearts and
Amen,
our lives,
Lord.
Let us not be proud or boastful, Lord, but
Amen.
Humble and true to your word, Lord
Amen.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
May we find you in the word. May we search for you daily, Lord,
Amen,
and spend
Lord.
Time when we find
Hallelujah.
You in your presence, Lord. May we rest and have peace in the Almighty God, the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we just love you so much. It's such a wonderful privilege just to be in your presence.
Lord. Amen, Lord.
Our words cannot explain it, Lord Jesus. May we just this week strengthen us. Everybody that's traveling, Lord, the baptism that we're going to do, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Blessed be your name, Lord. Such a wonderful time, Lord. And we just pray it in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Years and years I have labored, toil and tears for my need. Since my daddy's took me prisoner, sold me to slavery. But every day that I toil, the jubilee was drawing closer.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. The devil likes to remind you of things. You remind him of this.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Say, devil, I've got a history lesson for you. Amen. Then take him back to Calvary and all the way, hey, just keep going. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah, it's hard. Time. One day it'll be no more.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God bless you, friends. I'd like to have a photo. You don't want to just leave this atmosphere. Amen. But God bless you, friends. You're dismissed in Jesus Christ's name. We're going to have the church photo now. But yeah. We'll try and have it along here. But, sorry? So the baptism is, you go
past the Moonshine Bridge.
First, park on the left. Yeah. Okay, so let's get a row of chairs. We have two rows, and we'll try and all squish in here.